Meatheads, it's Travis, the American Butcher, and this, well, this is the Meat Block Podcast. The weekly podcast by butchers for everyone. This week, David and myself are going to be talking about some things. I don't know. David texted me beforehand and I forgot. If you like this mellow, relaxed intro of the Meat Block, this is brought to us by the one, the only, Guns N' Roses. Sit back, I get a hold of David on the ones and twos. Well, I figure out that technical jargon. Here's Axel. David?
Oh, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, hold on. Just hold on one second, okay?
To what? Am I right, ladies?
No, I just... I got to poop. Hold on. Give me 2 minutes.
Jesus, a quick poop.
It might be like three.
I'm recording this, by the way.
Okay, good. Good, good, good. Hold on one second.
All right.
But maybe pause the recording and then pick it back up in a few minutes.
Why don't you bring the microphone?
Yeah, we don't. Nobody wants that. I'll call you right back.
All right, bye. So while David's doing that, when I first started dating my wife, the first night she spent the night at my house, and I was trying to win her over for a while because that's what you do in these stories is the guy tries to win over the girl, and we were, you know, traditional love story. Just a lonely butcher living in Los Angeles. Counter help. I was in a position of power. I used that power to try to get a date with my subordinate. Actually, that's not that on paper, that's what it is, but in reality, I was in over my head. Not really in over my head. I just didn't have the support of the company, and I was head butcher / whatever at this company. And the person I could relate to the most about how much my life sucked was a girl who worked part-time at the counter, who was also a full-time banker. And her name was Melissa Cox, and everyone called her M2. And I would vent to her about my everyday life and her experience. And then we started connecting on a personal level, and we'd meet up and talk after work. And, you know, I think it was more sympathetic and pity she felt for me, which, hey, I'll take it. Whatever you got, I'll take it. You know, whatever gets me in there. And guess what, motherfuckers? I put a baby in there. So I'm winning. And so my whole story about pooping and all that is that when the first night she spent the night at my house, because that's how I do it. I'm non-secular. So she spent the night pretty early. And living in a studio apartment in downtown LA in the Miracle Mile District, just one block away from where Biggie Smalls got shot, literally two blocks away from the La Brea tar pits right there. I had a 2-inch gap underneath the door of my bathroom and the rest of my apartment because it was a studio. And I used to just get terrible morning diarrhea. And I went, and she told me years later, she's like, yeah, that first night or that first morning, I almost just left because I was super uncomfortable because I could just hear you violently having morning diarrhea. and you didn't turn on the TV or run the water or do anything to adjust for the fact that I was there. And guys, let me tell you right now, that's how you know you have a keeper, is when that exact situation happens. So hopefully David will call us back and we can stop with this potty talk and we can go back with the meat block and whatever David wanted to record about. Because that's what David wanted to do. He reached out to me and said, can you record tonight? And I said, I've had a few, David, but absolutely. I'd be honored. I'd be honored you if you graced me with your presence. Let's see if he's done making move. All right. David.
Yo.
How is your bowel movement?
Normal.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
I'm turning you up. Hold on. Talk. Let me get your levs.
Yep.
All right.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I could hear you. All right, listeners. Well, that was a lot longer than you thought, even though I told that amazing story about me and my wife meeting and me having horrible diarrhea the first night she spent the night and me just thinking that was normal. But once again, we are joined by David. So, David.
Hey, meatheads.
What do you have? Also, David, you didn't hear my amazing Ain't It Fun When You're Gonna Die Young intro that I recorded earlier.
No?
No.
What did I miss?
By Guns N' Roses. I just played some great music. And yeah. But how are you?
I did some pretty good music listening today too. I went to the record store, picked up a couple of vinyls that I've wanted for a while, and come to find out, Black Friday is like the second official record store day. So Black Friday, go to your local record store and pick up some vinyl, because the labels put out limited releases and they do some really special things. So
you
go support your local record store.
You buy new vinyl or do you just see?
Yeah, sometimes.
Okay.
Sometimes I do. These were used, but there's a lot of bands that I listen to that still put out vinyl. Usually they're pretty nice. They're like 180 gram or limited edition prints or, you know, whatever. But there's lots of bands that do.
Yeah.
There's a band, let's see. Today I picked up a used Sleep's new record. And if you listen to them at all, they're just like real heavy stoner metal. And I picked up an Ornette Coleman quartet that was used. But I know that a band that I really like called Pile just came out with a new vinyl, and yeah, it's a thing that people are doing still.
Yeah, I enjoy a good vinyl. David, either turn me down a little bit in your headphones or tighten them up, because I could hear a delayed latency.
How's that?
Hello? Better.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So I don't know if it's valuable at all, but my rarest vinyl I have is I used to live with this band, and their name was Downpressor, and their first album they put out, so listeners, and David, I'm sure you know this, but for our average listener, when you first make a vinyl, you do a test press just to see if the grooves work out correctly. And there are usually about 5 copies of that. And I own a couple of their test press.
Oh, wow.
Just to make sure that the press worked correctly during the vinyl making process.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I don't know if it turned out in their final press or whatever, but it's just like, they gifted it to me, and I was very appreciative.
That's pretty special.
Yeah, some of the members of the band don't even have that to this day. Maybe I should sell it.
Damn.
So, let me get a drink of water, David, real quick, because I accidentally inhaled a snowflake. I'm not talking about like some weak ass dude on the internet. I mean, like some actual fake snow.
Yeah. I'm going to move my internet hotspot because it seems to be kind of glitching out a little bit.
Okay.
One All second.
Right. All right.
Check.
Check. Check. David, can you hear me?
Yep, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Awesome.
So, how you been? What's new? What do you want to record? I told the listeners that this was your episode, so I'm here.
I just thought we could have a discussion.
Okay, good.
How's everything with your work going?
Fine. I don't know. Like, I think my work is doing this like big, like personally, like this big audit thing that I, for financial backers and uncertainties and things like that. Personally, I itemize it.
What kind of audit? Like a financial audit or like a food safety audit?
Financial viability audit. It's our yearly end of the year to allocate budgets and things like that. And that's never fun. And then personally with like just my myself involved in my work, I'm struggling personally to find meaning and happiness. That's why I don't mention where I work on the podcast. I don't know.
Do you think it's just kind of like that thing that happens after a while where things get stagnant and you're looking for something new, or is it something with your company in general?
The idea of my company is great, and the idea of my job is great. It's not being stagnant because I am a creature of habit, and I like knowing what every week and every year and everything is going to bring. I would say that my main problem has to do with evolving expectations in my direct, in the people above me.
Yeah.
That exponential growth is, I don't know, when you achieve something, and then I just don't want this to be me shitting on my work, because I'm very grateful and I understand that I have a very privileged salary for a lot of people in this industry. But when you do what I do and take numbers to where they are, where beyond what they were shown on paper years ago in a quicker time frame without the proper acknowledgement financially or even just verbally, like I don't know. And what makes me feel is like I'm a little bitch sometimes when it's like I'm not expecting to hear good job, but good job is good to hear.
Well, sure, you have to have some sort of positive reinforcement or at least like at least engaged coaching to keep you and your head in the game. You know, I mean, that's just part of the deal of good personnel management. You know, there's a statistic that Gallup put out into the world, and I think it's something like less than 30% of workers feel engaged in the work that they do every day or feel supported by their management.
Yeah.
And that's a direct result of coaching. You know, I mean, if you're a lot of us out there work in the type of place where you only talk to your boss once a year, then that's at a review. Mm-hmm. And it's a mystery as to what's going to happen. You know, yearly reviews should never, ever be a surprise. They should just be a continuation of an ongoing conversation.
Yeah. And with me, it's like I'm, I don't know, because my job is to get people motivated underneath me. I have people who support, who report directly to me. And then for me, myself, to not find that motivation and to keep me happy is, how could I keep someone who is making the bare minimum in this industry happy, who's doing a lot more work than a lot of other people in this industry, with my over, like, it's been an ongoing conversation for like 3 years. Like, once we get staffed appropriately, once we get staffed appropriately, once we get staffed appropriately, but once we finally could tread water, people leave to go to other places. People realize the money isn't that good, or people just get another job paying the same, doing roofing or doing something that's not in a cold room.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and that's a pretty good segue, or yeah, it's a pretty good segue into what, you know, we want to talk about tonight. And it has a lot to do with, has a lot to do with not being able to pay people what they're worth. And I think it is a systemic issue in food production in general, just because I think a lot of people want to put their money elsewhere.
Yeah.
Other than their food, you know, and it, that's everybody's right. Totally.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if material goods are more important than what we put in our body, then that's great. Everybody, it's not for us to dictate, but there can't be a ton of surprise when the food system's broken, you know?
Yeah. Was that you or me, David?
That was me, and I'm going to turn it off.
Okay.
The computer doesn't really want to do that, though. It really wants me to hear those.
Yeah, it's just, it's weird because you always hear that people who work for a large chain or whatever, that they complain about their money, right? And food is, it's a necessity, like we need it, but it's also a commodity when you want to pay for the luxuries of organic and all that. But then all the buzzwords, organic, free range, all this, still pay their employees the same amount.
Right. Yeah, so true. And I wonder if it's as black and white as that. I mean, there aren't that many like JBS style plants that are doing organic, certified humane, certified grass fed. And, you know, I mean, it's just, those are the numbers you have to hit to really be efficient and really make your margins, I think. I mean, in the current system. This all came up. The reason why we're talking about this is there was an article that was put out by the Argus Courier. It's entitled "Petaluma Ranchers Beefing About Slaughterhouse Access."
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the caption is, a cattle ranch, I don't want to name any names just because we didn't ask for permission, but someone from a cattle ranch in California, they're being forced to close their business after the local processor told them they're no longer able to slaughter animals from small farms. Right.
Mm-hmm.
This slaughterhouse, which again, we don't want to name any names because we didn't ask. But the only USDA certified meat processing plant in this particular area. And they've informed ranchers that starting January, it will no longer process animals for private labels. And, the farmer says this puts us out of business of selling to the retail market. You know, knowing our community is losing the ability to harvest locally, it's going to have a tremendous impact on agricultural infrastructure. It's going to have a negative effect on local agriculture. This is something we see all the time. I mean, you know, you've got a cut and wrap facility that's USDA inspected. They do a bunch of what we call now private label stuff, also known as custom work, third party work, whatever. And it's where local customers come. I mean, this is the majority of my background is working for places like this, you know, and I don't know if you would consider it to be the majority of yours, but certainly many years of yours. You've worked in a lot of different parts of it, but this is a huge thing. You got a small cut and wrap, got a small staff, you're killing, you're cutting, you're doing value-added product, you're packing in retail packs, you're accommodating custom labels. You can hear from the tone of my voice that I feel I'm not biased, but there's a lot of moving parts here.
Well, you'd say that you're passionate about the topic.
Yeah, I am. You know, and it's not something that I have an answer for. So my goal is for us to just have a discussion and open it up to the listening audience, for us to field a lot of feedback. There's going to be all kinds of perspectives that we're not going to name here, that we're not going to go into, that we haven't thought of, that we don't represent, or that we're leaving off just to be invocative, I think. And then we can have another discussion about this, because there's going to be a lot of people that are going to maybe even want to talk to us on their show about it. But so anyways, this is what happens. You've got these small facilities. You've got a bunch of local farmers, local ranchers, whatever, that bring one or two head a week, maybe up to 10, 15 a week, mm-hmm. tops. You know, that's an ideal customer. But even when there's 10 or 15 head a week in a small plant, that's a huge chunk of your business. And if you're selling all 15 of those head, as quarters, that's essentially having to organize 60 different beef.
Yeah.
You know, and the organization for something like that, if you think about it, you know, there's that, you know, ageless stereotype about, you know, you take your beef in and it comes out the other end and you don't know if it's your stuff. And how many ranchers have you had talk to you and say, this doesn't look like my beef?
Too many.
Too many. And you've got a great story that you've told on the show about that, about one particular individual, you know. And
if you want to listen to that story, just go back and start with episode one until now.
Was that? Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, that's the thing is like when a beef comes in and you got to split four different ways, four different customers, four different cut sheets. And, you know, let's just talk about me for a minute, mm-hmm. the place where I work. I've got single? Seven cutters. I'm not married.
Ladies, do you hear that?
You got seven cutters.
Stop. Cork it up, ladies.
Seven cutters, eight packagers, you know, two swing lids. We've got a rail. We can, you know, we generally do, we process wholesale beef, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like boxed meat to go out to retail outlets where they break it down further for the case. Because, you know, as we all know, it's extremely difficult for retail outlets to bring in whole animals. That subject is another podcast. But when we do that, we rail out seven whole beef at a time and break them all in phases. So when we take the chuck off, we take 14 chucks off.
Yeah.
When we take the rib section, we take 14 at a time. And so when you have, say we railed out seven whole beef that are split into quarters, that's 28 customers that you have to separate, keep their cut sheets the same, keep them organized, have everything labeled by customer, separated on racks so that when it does make it through the label station, they're not mixing up customers. I mean, it's incredibly difficult. Incredibly difficult.
Yeah. No,
not impossible.
Yeah. It so the Henry Ford model of production hates when customers break their animals down into quarters or eighths, or even having every carcass be a different customer, because finding that flow is just it's impossible.
There is no flow.
No.
You have to have like three to four lines, three to four bandsaws, three to four breakers just to have, you know, if I'm going to break 20 beef in a day, 20 whole beef, my crew mm-hmm. can do that on a wholesale level. But when,
and I have numbers I could speak of later.
Like let's say we do 20 whole beef in a day. Mm-hmm. For us to do 20 customer beef, that's impossible. If we're doing customer beef, we'll probably do 7 to 8 whole in a day that mm-hmm. are generally broken into quarters and halves. So all of a sudden, my income gets cut in half. Mm-hmm. Just right there, right then and there. But then my packaging costs go 4X.
Yeah, but also... because
everything's single-pack steaks.
That's the thing, is the single-pack steaks, and you're spending time flipping your room, resetting, making sure there isn't those fuck-ups that farmers say, this isn't my beef, is that you have to... never want to have that conversation. You do the best you can to not have that conversation. So you take breaks, say, this is this person's beef. Let the packagers know, etc. And they're getting their stuff at a non-discounted price because they're not producing in bulk. Because if I was a processor and someone says, I could give you three animals once a week, maybe, versus the person that says, I'll give you 20 animals a week. Definitely, I'm going to give that 20 animals a price break and make sure that that customer is happy with my prices and speed.
Of course. Okay. So, you know, and I feel like I'm getting the cart before the horse. One thing I wanted to, okay, so this is a huge issue, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's small processors around the entire country closing all the time. The custom exempt shops, I feel like, are doing pretty well still. They're still rolling. But that's definitely more of an East Coast and Midwestern thing.
Yeah.
The West Coast is very farmers market and retail market oriented. And so we're in this unique position in history. And okay, so these places are closing left and right, and ranchers are put in a super tough spot. When I was in Michigan raising sheep and lamb for retail, I mean, I had to drive a long way to get processed, and there were people that would drive from the UP 10 hours to get processed. There were people that would drive from the Chicago area. I mean, it was insane because there aren't enough places. Right? This is the first time in history where everybody that's raising a few animals in on their property, in their backyard, or on their ranch, whatever it may be. Say, you know, somebody's raising 2,000 head a year. Somebody's got a 500 cow-calf operation. Somebody, you know, has got – they're doing 50 head a year and want to bring you 1 to 2 animals a week for 50 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever. It's the first time in history where everybody has wanted to have a USDA bug on every single steak that goes out.
Yeah.
You know, historically, if you're a rancher that has, you know, 50 head a year, a lot of that business was based on custom exempt freezer beef sales.
Mm-hmm.
So you're selling to people in your community. Everybody gets a quarter or a half, fills their freezer for the year, feeds their family. No big deal. Money exchanges hands. The government's not involved. That was a viable model for a very long time for people. But now that the farmers market is going, and now that you've got the co-op system and small retailers, like these small boutique natural food stores that are willing, and this is such an awesome opportunity. Don't get me wrong. I think it's fantastic, and it's definitely helped me in the past, and it's very exciting as a producer. You got these small boutique grocery stores that want to carry local ranchers' meat. Everybody's got to have a USDA bug. And so this is kind of the first time where we're really posed with this problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what do you feel? We acknowledge the problem, right? That there is a lack of USDA processing facilities, or that there is, but they can no longer accommodate because of their own financials.
Yeah, that's correct.
So when I worked in Vermont, I think the place that I worked at, I've said it, they're out of business, and I've said it 100 times, Westminster Meats, that they got government assistant, or they got, I don't know if it's government, they got grants from grant writers, because they were providing a service to small farms and small scale agriculture. They got over $150,000 in grants because of their services. And I know that a local MPU up here in Washington. That's no longer there because of just headaches and trials and tribulations. Got 100% of their financing through grant writing process. Through
Are you talking about the one over, you know, further west that your friend is involved in, or the one up near you?
I mean, it was a poultry one.
Oh, I gotcha. Gotcha.
Yeah. So, and then I know that the one that's further west had a lot of grant writing as well with money. So I know that I don't know how that works. It's something I've never been a part of and not going to pretend like I am. So I don't know if that is part of the equation for the, we recognize a problem, we need a solution. Is that part of the solution? If so, if you're the listener that writes grants or whatever, do it.
I think there's a couple of big problems. One of the big problems is that the Cut and Wrap, in my opinion, is no longer able to be a one-stop shop.
Mm-hmm.
You know, ranchers want to come to you and they want the kill. So let's say in average, I just did kind of a benchmark pricing analysis around the country for things, because we're trying to look at our pricing. And the thing that I've found is the average kill price for a head of beef is $80.
And that's rendering disposal.
Going from coast to coast.
Okay.
Well, that's not the actual cost. That's the cost to the customer.
Okay.
That's not what it truly costs to do it.
Yeah.
And so $80 a head. So let's think about this. I'm thinking about a kill floor that I worked for. There was six of us.
Mm-hmm.
And we could do 3 to 4 beef an hour.
Okay.
Right? So let's say it's three. Let's say it's 3 beef an hour. And it wasn't six of us. It was actually 4 of us, because one person just did paperwork and the other person basically just changed the radio.
But they're also getting paid.
They're getting paid, though. So let's say it's 5 people.
Mm-hmm.
Each of these people, let's just say, makes $15 an hour.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just say 16 for a round number, even though that's a little high. Okay. So that's $4 per person per head, right?
Yeah.
Well, it's about five bucks. And then there's the 6 people. So that's $30, and it's an $80 kill fee. So you're making $50 off of that. And that's after wages are paid.
Mm-hmm.
Then you've got the rendering fee per pound. You've got all of your overhead included, which is, you know, I mean, a small plant probably still pays $5,000 to $6,000 a month in electricity because of cooling and HVAC.
Mm-hmm.
Your rendering fees through the roof. You've got workers' comp and workers' comp insurance, which every time somebody has to get one single stitch, that goes up.
Mm-hmm. Your company
every at? Back injury. What's that?
I said, what's your company at as far as number of days, David?
Oh, we don't even keep track.
Oh. Well, I just want to gloat real quick. We are at 1,500 days. Over four.
Nice.
Yeah, about over 4 years. Anyway, continue.
Yeah, and that's a cultural thing. You know, I didn't have any workers' comp when I was in the Midwest, because I was mostly working with, like, farm, you know, people who worked on farms or people worked in the oil fields, really, really, really hard workers. But in other parts of the country, you've got a generational thing where people haven't been working for a long time. Nobody wants to work, and back injuries are very, very popular ways of not working.
Yeah.
You know, you've got your laundry service for uniforms. You've mm-hmm. got your water bill. You've got, I mean, there's so much that goes into killing a head of beef.
Yes.
By the time that $80 fee rolls around, you're maybe making $5-$10, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
If not losing money.
Yeah. No, definitely. If you're, depending on your lease, or depending if you own the land, or if it's a mixed use property where you also have a farm on your property and things like that, you know.
And then you've got the Cut and Wrap, which the average price around the country right now is 80 cents a pound. So it's 80 and 80. 80 cents a pound for a 1,000-pound steer brings you in $800. the economics there are extremely, extremely tight by the time you shake everything out. Because, I mean, all your maintenance is there, all of your equipment, all of your consulting fees, all of your lab testing fees. I mean, you send out one product for a shelf life test, mm-hmm. you're looking at $2,000.
And the frequency of those tests?
It depends on what the model of your business is. You know, if you've got a little retail shop in the front and you want to know what your shelf life is, I mean, it could be, it depends on how many items you have. You know, it might be a one-time deal, but, and that's if things go ideal. It's just an incredibly, the margins are incredibly tight. And that's why these places go out of business all the time. So I think that, you know, the model for a lot of the cut and wraps is push, 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 more and more and more and more and more. Because mm-hmm. the more you put through, the wider your margin gets. But in these small facilities, most of the time they're not very efficient because mm-hmm. they can't be. You know, they're operating on 15,000 square feet or less, and they want to have three departments with seven asset plans. Mm-hmm. And it's incredibly difficult because everybody wants to offer every option under the sun because of, you know, the artisanal meat trade where we have all these specialty products, which is great. And it's been very engaging for the consumer. It's been a total boon for ranchers out there who, you know, I mean, we would have people come to us and they would ask me for, you know, one person would ask me for lamb belly bacon. Man, I can't make any money off my lamb. We're in the Midwest. Nobody buys it, but people buy the lamb belly bacon. Can you make that for me? Well, yeah, I can do it, but I lost my ass every time I made it because it was so labor intensive.
Mm-hmm.
And it was such a small batch, right?
Yeah.
Would you have any thoughts on this?
So we're in this fictitious plant we're talking about. I just want to know our numbers and our staff. So what's our numbers per day? What did you say? You said 15. Oh,
let's say it's a very small facility that I used to work at. Let's say we'd cut. There was two cutters, two wrappers, and one person grinding or making sausage. Right.
Okay.
I broke. I ran the saw. I cut, and then I had somebody on the boning table. We had a labeler, one packer, and then one grinder. We would try to cut six whole beef a day.
Okay.
And 99% of those were in quarters or eighths because we offered eighths.
So it's my input is going to come from the processor making money, not from the farmer getting what he wants. I just want to preface that because I'm on this side of the industry. What I would recommend is a standard cut sheet that is X amount per pounds for the cut and wrap.
Yeah, but we have fought that fight though. You know, like nobody wants that anymore. Nobody wants to choose between a chuck steak and a chuck roast.
And I know that.
Everybody wants a mock tender, flat iron, Denver, boneless short ribs, chuck eye, Delmonico. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And I get
that's what sets the ranches apart. And I totally get it because that's what makes your booth worth stopping at.
And that's why the next cut sheet is worth X amount more per pound for any alterations, even if it's one. And then, David, I know your next thing is that people won't pay for it. But if people are going out of business because they can't get their stuff processed, then I don't know the solution other than that because the money has to be made on one end or the other. If depending on their clientele, it's like if I want to break a four quarter down on a block to get that 2 inches more the teres major versus running through the bandsaw and not giving a fuck how it turns out, and I can make a lot more money, I may tell the farmer this is just how it is, unless they want to pay X more a pound.
And that's so I currently have two cut sheets. I have what's called the family freezer beef cut sheet and then the farmer's market sheet. And that has worked fairly well. There's been kind of some a little bit of enthusiasm about paying more. Mm-hmm. But I also just had a consultant come through and do a costing analysis and figured out exactly what it costs to light 1 square foot of the floor. You know, we really know what it costs. Mm-hmm. And the average processing prices around the country between 80 cents and $1 a pound are not enough to pay your workers a living wage. You know, we're in this conversation now. I was just talking about this earlier with somebody, a friend of mine who's in food policy, and we're not talking about minimum wage anymore. We're talking about a living wage at this point.
Yeah.
And 80 cents a pound to process beef in an artisanal cut and wrap situation. That's not enough.
No. Yeah, that's.
But that's what they're paying. I mean, we were looking at this benchmark pricing analysis, and there's people out there, there's plants out there that are in the deep south that are still charging $35 a head and 66 cents a pound to process beef.
So
that's scary.
I don't know how living wage equates throughout region to region, but I do know historically that, I'm sorry if you live in Alabama, but the butchers in our industry on this website that I looked at earlier is that who make the least are in Alabama and historically are in the South. Who make the most are in Hawaii and Connecticut, but that also has to do with cost of living.
This is because Sean is out there and he keeps tipping the scales because he keeps winning all these contests.
True, but he keeps tipping down the scales when he gets in these online dick measuring contests. Sean, I know you listen. I know. You got a bigger dick. And you may not show it to everyone either.
My mom listens to this, BT Dubs.
So does my mom. Hi, Mom. Look forward to seeing you during Thanksgiving.
Okay, so it's obvious. We feel protective of our part of the industry because we're having a hard time paying our workers a wage that keeps them around, keeps them engaged, keeps them interested,
yeah.
Keeps the lights on. We're having a hard time. We are that processor.
Because, David, if you were to ask me what my number one problem with this industry is, it would be personal, and it would be that I cannot keep workers. To that event, that it is affecting my job because me keeping workers keeps a sense of stability to my work and to my life. And when that is upturned, it gets me in these depressive episodes where now I'm working so hard to achieve what should already be figured out.
Well, and we want to be able to give opportunities to people like we were given. I mean, we want people to be engaged in their work and love what they do and want to show up every day and feel a sense of pride in everything they do. So do ranchers. Mm-hmm. And ranchers probably have it even worse than butchers do. You know, they work endless hours,
yeah,
and get paid very, very little and are constantly overshadowed by Big Ag. And so it's, I 100% support the frustration by ranchers and producers. So I'm griping about our side of the industry and the difficulties that we have, right? And mm-hmm. we can go into more detail about a profit and loss statement and what that looks like,
yeah,
during an average month of processing animals. But I've been on the other side of it as well. And it's hard. It's super, super hard.
So I just want to tell you, I did that Focus on Farming talk a couple weeks ago. And I got a chance to see one of the keynote speakers before I had to leave and go to my work. And they were saying that their number one problem in farming, ranching, whatever you want to call it. Don't know the difference between farming and ranching. But was staffing. And you look at it this way, that they said, why would people want to get into ranching with these ag program government breaks? You could pay your staff less money to do more work and feel less appreciated. So why is that something that people would want to get into? And they were answering that question or presenting the answers of like, how do we get past that? All right, a future. How could we get your staff motivated in the future in your company? How could we have them get a sense of meaning out of the work they're doing? How could we, is it worth changing our prices to not give them that government allowed cut that we're allowed to because we're fall under the ag program.
Oh, you're talking about like government exemptions, like back when we were exempt from certain wages.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And what they broke that down is that the average income or low end income for college educated people in America was like $15 an hour, right? Mm-hmm. To go get a job wherever. And what ranches with that government
exemption
is paying is about $10.20. That's like $22,000 a year or $27,000 a year. Why would anyone want that?
Yeah, I think it's 22.
Yeah. So like how do you convince people motivated to give you a good job and a good honest day's work when they can literally go work anywhere else for more money? Literally.
Yep, it's true. Okay, so let's see. The costs of processing are very, very high, and it's extremely inefficient when you've got a one-stop shop, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We've come up with that. Ranchers need it's no longer, from what I'm understanding, from what I'm hearing, custom exempt freezer beef is no longer a viable market. People, you know, Americans are eating less meat. Families are smaller. People's type of work is changing, so we don't have as many hard laborers out there eating as many calories. It makes sense, okay? But I get it. We're not selling halves of beef to a family of four anymore. They're not eating 500 pounds of beef a year. I get it. So, and again, we're just getting the tip of the iceberg here with this discussion because we could talk for hours on it, and I expect that we will, but we're just kind of cracking this open for us to talk more. I'd be curious to know more about co-ops and how they work. Mm-hmm. Because it occurs to me that this many ranchers have this problem. And this many processors have this problem. And we tend to be on two sides of one fence perpetually, putting the blame back and forth. This is what I hear in the industry. Processors blame the ranchers. Ranchers blame the processors. And maybe it's not even like that. Maybe people are just frustrated at the situation. It's nobody's fault. I'm curious about what it looks like. I'd love to get like Jim on here sometime to talk about the mechanics of a cooperative not-for-profit processor, because
I'll have Linda Knutson. I'll give you her contact off mic, because she's in charge of agriculture in Snohomish County and is part of the board of IGFC and co-op member, and who set me up at Focus on Farming. She's the one who spearheads all that.
I'd love to have her on the show because I'd love to know what the mechanics look like. Not the specifics necessarily, but the mechanics of how it works and why it's not happening in other places. And maybe it's still too new. Maybe not enough people have proof that it works, or maybe not enough people have organized. But I'd love to know more about the co-ops and how they work. Another thing that I would really like to, and I've mentioned this on the show before, but I really think that this would be something that, could potentially be something to brainstorm on. And that's about decentralizing the processing. You know, in a small plant that's 20,000 square feet or less, it's going to put through 2,000 head of beef or less a year. It's usually incredibly inefficient to kill, cut and wrap, and produce VAP with multiple HACCP plans under one roof.
Mm-hmm.
You've got a lot of cross-contamination issues. You've got cold storage issues, cross-training issues, finding specialized personnel, things like that. I wonder if we broke that up into a model where maybe it's a kill facility or a kill cut and wrap facility, but then the VAP is a completely different entity, kind of like a co-packer, but one that's either cooperative or an extension of that original processor, but is a totally different facility. So, you know, and so, yeah.
I was going to say, when I've seen that model in the past, that it is completely different staff, that you don't have your kill floor manager managing your cut and wrap, that you don't have your cut and wrap manager managing the smokehouse.
Exactly. And, so instantly things get more efficient.
Yeah. And what also you don't have is, you don't have, hey, this person called in sick, could we have this person from the kill floor jump into, in the middle of the day, the smokehouse? Which, yeah, I've seen before.
I mean, if you had a kill facility that's all they did,
mm-hmm.
and you charged $80-$85 a head, and you had a staff of eight or less, and could just push beef, hogs, lamb, and potentially poultry through single species a day, and just max that out, and had proper cold storage,
mm-hmm.
and a decent shipping dock, and then you had a cut and wrap down the road, and then you've got a VAP processor down the road. I personally think, based on balancing my own books in the plant, that it would be easier to make a profit if they were all separate businesses.
Easier for all three businesses?
Absolutely. Because from an accounting perspective, you have full traceability and visibility into what part of your business uses what. So you know where your money's going. For instance, in a plant where you have three departments, it's incredibly difficult to figure out who is using what packaging materials.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there generally isn't like a buying and selling of product between business entities. So it's between production units, rather, under one roof. So it's incredibly difficult to get the true cost of items as they go through. So, you know, if we could actually focus more on true costing of processing, rather than kind of word of mouth folk ways, which is what it is now. I mean, quite frankly, any plant I've worked for, aside from the one that I'm at now, the pricing has been based on what other people in the area do.
Yeah.
You know, and those prices have not gone up with inflation, not the way that they should.
Now, David, what if that person, so we have our three plants, our slaughter, our cut, our smokehouse, because people don't understand added value processing. But what if the slaughter person says, hey, I could cut that up in eighths for you, or cut that up in quarters for you, and then they want to start eating into that? What would stop the chain from adding and then... You know, because you have to rely on the person ahead of you from not absorbing the other plants or the other steps.
Totally. Yeah. No, you're absolutely right. That's a great point. And I think that that's where the cooperative model has to work.
Because I think that, yeah, people would want to understand, like, okay, I'm a farmer, right? And when I'm saying this, David, I'm not agreeing or disagreeing with you in any sense. I'm just posing this.
Please. No, I mean, we're trying to figure this thing out.
If someone says, like, hey, man, I want XXXXX, and this farmer says, and the processor says, absolutely, I could do that, and you could, and then I'll pre-ship it in a couple days, and then I'll go here, then they'll pre-ship it in a week, and then I'll go here, and then it'll be pre-shipped from there in a month from now. Or I could pre-ship and take away step two, then send it to your smokehouse in one day or 2 days. Then you can get your product versus that month 2 weeks from now. Because people like that one. It's why people go to Walmart and Costco, because it's the one stop shop. And I'm not, like, I just want to pose that question. I'm not saying that, like, one thing I firmly believe is people who say they're the jack of all trades and master of none, that really means that they, yeah.
I mean, you're totally right. I mean, but I think that's where the growing pains are going to show up, is when people realize what the true cost is. Because if somebody wants to eat into the other entity's business, mm-hmm. eventually, they're just going to get overwhelmed and backed up, and then we're back to the model we're in right now.
And essentially, in a co-op model, that wouldn't happen either, right? Because it'd be the farmers who would be part of who would the entity's best interest would be.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah. So if you've got the perpetual problem is that people can't process what they kill.
Yes.
That's the number, right? I mean, that's the number one thing. But if you've got a kill facility that can kill 100 head a day, and you've got, a processing facility can only do 30 head a day, well, then we need to open three processing facilities.
So we've got three processing
that many more jobs.
Okay. We got three processing facilities. When a new processing facility, or not a new, when an existing established processing facility in my area hires someone, my USDA inspector says, hey, do you know such and such? Because it's such a small hiring pool.
Oh, yeah.
That how it's, and I totally agree with the not having the kill person work in the smokehouse and et cetera, et cetera. And having separate entities, but how do you staff three separate businesses when you and myself are having trouble staffing our one?
You're right. I mean, that's a huge issue too, and we can't solve it all with just one thing. I mean, that's a great point, very good point. But I think we're going to find out what the true cost of process is. I mean, I look at it like this right now. I've been. Go ahead.
I was going to say, right now, our whatever we have is broken.
Yeah, super broken.
Yeah,
but the part of the industry that is not broken, that is working, where people are making money, are in co-packers and co-processors. Mm-hmm. Okay, and I've been consulting on a deal recently where a company wants to basically just kill animals. And then they want to utilize a slaughterhouse, but then they want to send out their cuts, their quarters or their eighths to processors in different regions. This is kind of like what big aggregators do, right? Like they have kill floors in regions, and then they've got a processor in a region, then they've got a co-packer in a region. And if you've ever dealt with a co-packer, you know that chances are you have had your animal broken down at a processor. You've paid that fee. That packaging fee, that shipping fee, that transportation. And then you take your raw materials and you send it to a co-packer, and one of two things happens. You either sell them your meat and they process it and then they sell it back to you for a higher price, or it's a fee for service model. Mm-hmm. Either way, there's fees attached to it. And in that model, you actually see the true costs of what it takes to put a consumer packaged good on the shelf, which is ultimately what the farmer's market is. It's a CPG entity. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about wholesale. It's all consumer packaged goods. And so in that model, when you're a big aggregator, you actually have visibility into those different costs. And that's how co-packers are making money. That's how Bruce Pack up in Oregon is making money. You know, they also have a 5,000-pound minimum run per SKU.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's how, like, Hemplers up here. Hemplers has their own brand, and they make money off of that, honestly. But if you want to co-pack, use them to make your hot dogs, then you have to give them 5,000 pounds of meat, of raw materials, for them to even consider you using your own raw materials. Otherwise, they'd be like, nah, how about you just buy our raw materials, because we'll make guaranteed money on that.
Yeah, and that's how it's efficient. That's how you're going to pay for that $350,000 roll stock machine that everybody wants in the farmer's market circuit right now, is by doing volume. Mm-hmm. So when you bring me five hogs a week and you want every single cut down the cut list, and you want linked sausage and some bulk sausage and bacon and hams, but I've got 50 other customers, how am I supposed to do that?
Yeah. No, it's... I work for like a smaller added value company, and if it, we won't even
first question we ask is people, like, I have this thing I want you to make for us. It's like, all right, whose raw materials are we using?
Yeah.
Because if it's yours, then it's gonna be the same amount of work versus ours. Plus right. Losing 80% of it. Yeah, and we have minimums. And when I mean small, I mean real, real small. So I agree with you 100% through the slaughter and the cut and wrap, but how does the added value in the smokehouse make money supporting farmers who do four hogs a week or 10 hogs a week?
Well, you have to do a costing analysis, and you have to figure out how much it actually costs you with your labor and the organization and the cold storage and the packaging and all of your overhead to pay that close of attention to a small run for a small rancher. What's the cost? Mm-hmm. And if you have a cooperative model, ranchers can come watch your operation, and you might have a rancher that's got experience in manufacturing. They might say, at the board meeting, not on the floor, obviously, hey, I was by the smokehouse. I've got some ideas on how we can be a little bit more efficient. Let's get together and brainstorm. That's right. I mean, I don't know any other way to get the full visibility into the true cost of producing small run boutique meat other than busting it wide open and having everybody have eyes on it. Or just trusting the process, but it has to be true cost. It can't be old timey cost. It can't be 75 cents a pound for linked sausages when casings cost $1,500 a bucket.
Yeah. No, I get it. And I just personally would not want to introduce that level of scrutiny into my everyday life. Of processing, of inviting strangers.
Well, no, I hear you. I mean, it's not ideal, but I feel like there's so much siloing of information that people just, they don't understand it. Maybe there's a different model. Maybe there's a cooperative ranching model that links up with the cooperative processing model. Maybe instead of 10 different small ranchers, maybe there's one pork brand. Mm-hmm. That these 10 ranchers get together and compromise on quality standards.
So what?
And that, go ahead.
Well, you finished. Then I'm going to present a question.
Yeah. Well, yeah. So maybe there's a partner farm program where everybody has, the same standards. And instead of sending 4 hogs a week per ranch, they send 40 hogs a week, and it's done in batch processing. And then it starts to get efficient for the processor. Costs go down, and people start to be able to make a little bit more money, and the consumer may even feel it a little bit.
All right, David. How do farmers start a cooperative? What is the first step? Where do you buy the cart? Where do you buy the horse?
Like, I feel like I could speculate a little bit, but I feel like we're going to have to bring somebody in for this one.
Okay. Because I don't know. And I'm not trying to put you on the spot. Or
no, it's a great, I mean, I could think about how I would want to do it if I was going to do it. I mean, you've got a guy up in Oregon, Cody, right? You talked to Cody, didn't you? Or Ryan did.
Yeah.
I think that their system is kind of a cooperative system where there's many ranchers that are working for one brand, and that's how it works because they have guaranteed sales. Nobody's taking anything to the sales barn.
Yeah, but do you think every rancher is going to want to?
No, they may not, but not everybody can have their cake, eat it too, and have everybody watch them while they're eating it. You know what I mean?
I know. Like, while I was in the middle of saying that, I'm like, well, that's how all big ag works. It's like, there is not a Cargill farm. There is not a JBS farm. There is
totally
multiple farms.
Yeah.
No, I get that. And Cody, sorry to compare you to those other small farms.
I mean, the model is smart. It's just when things get big, there's a lack of sincerity and there's like quality issues. But I think that there's a middle ground. And this is something we could talk about on another episode. I know we're getting a little long here, but I think I think that there's an option. Basically, the thing is like we've got a problem. It seems unfixable in the way that it's working right now. So we have to update the system.
Yeah. No, and I want a solution because I want longevity for us and other people like us in the industry.
Mm-hmm.
For many reasons, I don't like working as hard as I do to feel like shit every day.
Yeah.
Even though, like, I'm looking out right now at the on the sound, and it looks pretty great. But
yeah.
I don't know. David, I think this is a good episode.
Yeah, we've generated some ideas here. This is just the tip of the iceberg, and we're hoping to field lots of opinions, aligned or otherwise. Lots of reminders, lots of perspective. Anybody that wants to give us some feedback on this idea or any criticism or anything like that, we'd love for this to be a larger conversation that we revisit again.
Yeah. And David's mom, I'm sorry for swearing and using profanity.
My mom doesn't even know what a podcast is.
I thought you said she listened. You were being facetious.
I lied.
I thought you were leaning into it, like not even leaning into it, because you said it was such like, and when I said my mom does listen, she does. See,
your mom's a modern gal.
All right, David, I edited that part out where I talked about stuff, but I will still say cunt.
Perfect.
Sorry if you're listening to this and you heard that word and it offended you. I mean it in the utmost beautiful sense and passionate sense, the English sense. All right.
Well, I'm glad we started talking about this, and I look forward to talking more about it.
David, are you glad with how this episode turned out?
Yeah, so far so good.
All right. Well, pick the next. You? Yeah.
Good.
Yeah. I'm going to publish it now, and it'll be good.
Okay.
Wait, what do you say now at the end? Until?
Next time.
Keep your knife sharp.
And live in the margin.
Yep. Glad to see you still listen to the show, because I recently changed it and changed it back. All right. And that is, and stop.